Hello and welcome! In the last update video to my VRM project, I told that I'm waiting for the last parts to arrive so I can do some final tests needed for the first official release. Well, unfortunately, I'm still waiting for the parts and there seem to be some delivery issues. However, I was impatient and wanted to move on, so I salvaged some parts from scrap. Different coils, different capacitors, some are too big, the others had to be stocked one on the other, but I could finish my tests and collect the results I needed. Now the prototype is ready to be released. In the last video I showed you already how a single voltage Intel Pentium 100 and a dual voltage Pentium MMX were both powered by the VRM module at 3.2 volts, respectively 2.8 volts. I tested also other voltages with a lab power supply and everything looked already quite good. Even the voltage ripple was far below allowed 100 mV, pending somewhere between 50 and 70 mV. That is sufficient for a stable work, but lower is better, so I slightly improved the input filtering and could get the effective voltage ripple below 30 mV, mostly pending around 20 mV. That was a very good result and it was time to make the real deal. In the beginning of this series, I showed the very first and simple revision of the VRM, which I designed for the Pentium MMX. It was designed for up to 6 amps, but with a lot of cooling and some modifications, I could convince this mainboard to run with an AMD K6-2 at 400 MHz. However, at that speed, the CPU pulls around 11 amps of current, and after only a couple of minutes, the VRM overheated desperately. A lot of time passed since then, and meanwhile, I have a much more efficient VRM in my hands. I used for testing this AMD K6-2 450 MHz, which should run at 100 MHz FSB, multiply 4.5 and 2.4 volts. However, our mainboard supports only 66 MHz frontside bus and a multiplier of 6, as I explained it in the previous parts. So the CPU would run at 400 MHz with lower frontside bus and 50 MHz lower effective clock. The voltage setting on the VRM can be reduced to 2.2 volts. And we are getting exactly 2.2 volts core voltage. The system boots fine and the voltage ripple is again very low. Interesting is that as soon as DOS is loaded, the CPU seems to fall into some kind of energy saving mode, where ripple goes up to values around 50 millivolts. As soon as we put some load, here PC player benchmark for example, the ripple falls below 50 millivolts again. Interesting. The regulator is stone cold so far, but let it run for a while and check the temperature afterwards. About 20 minutes passed and PC player benchmark was running all the time. The regulator and the whole system seems to be stable. Now the interesting question. The first revision of the VRM was able to power the CPU, but even with a bigger fan and heat sinks on the regulators, the temperature went over 70 degrees Celsius in only a couple of minutes. I guess that's why so many comments were suggesting various improvements related to the temperature. Well, after about 20 minutes, we are getting 26 degrees Celsius on the regulator. The parts are barely warm. The room temperature is around 20 degrees Celsius. The fan holds the CPU temperature at only about 23 degrees Celsius. It is very cool, but K6-2 didn't get very hot anyway. The CPU fan blows also some air on the regulator, and without that, the VRM would be probably slightly warmer as well. The good news is that the onboard linear voltage regulator is now relaxing at only 23 degrees Celsius. Would it need to power the CPU and deliver 11 amps at 2.2 volts? It wouldn't. But if it would, we'd probably be able to melt the solder with it. So with the switching VRM, this board is not only much more powerful, it also should live much longer. So the good news is that we finally reached the target and an AMD K6-2 400 MHz runs stable in this mainboard, which initially was designed to support only non-MMX 166 MHz Pentium 1. How much performance increase it is, this will be a topic for the next video. I already made some excessive tests and benchmarks, but there are still some more tests to be done before I'm ready to publish them. And today I would like to talk about some design considerations and open source this project. As you see, this is the revision 0.3, and it was my work in progress revision to iron out the most critical issues. In short, let's see how it is built up. Here on the right four pins, we are getting 5 volts input voltage. There we see two big input capacitors to flatten down the low frequency ripple. The 5 volt supply goes into this transistor, which is controlled by the DC-DC controller here. Above we have some smaller ceramic capacitors to flatten high frequency input ripple. Left of the controller we have the compensation network, which is responsible for smooth startup and run of the controller. Here one capacitor is still missing, but it is not critical. The circuit works also without it, but I hope to get even lower ripple if I get the parts eventually. Then we have some resistors and the selection switches, which act as feedback voltage divider to control the output voltage. The DC-DC controller switches the two transistors alternately, dependent on the required output voltage. The current goes through the inductor, I'll talk about it later, and goes to the four low ESR output capacitors, which flatten the low and mid frequency ripple. Here one interesting fact, capacitors with low capacity have usually lower ESR. That's why it is better to have many smaller capacitors than a big one with the same overall capacity. That's why you usually see a lot of capacitors in the power supply circuits in parallel instead of a big one. It is all about the output voltage ripple. On this regulator we have only 4 caps because there is not a lot of space. I could theoretically squeeze more, but I used quite low ESR caps, and so 4 turned out to be sufficient for what we need. Of course, bigger output capacitors are not enough against the high frequency ripple, and that's why we also have some smaller ceramic capacitors here as additional filters. The row of the middle pins is the output voltage, and the very left 4 pins are ground. Right from it we have 3.3 I/O voltage pins, sense, power, OK signal, etc. That's a short overview of the circuit. Now let's talk about the development state. As you saw, the temperature is not nearly a problem anymore, especially compared to the first revision of the VRM, so the issue can be considered as solved. The voltage ripple was something where I had to experiment a lot, but with under 50 millivolts it is quite okay. As I said, the parts which I ordered didn't arrive in time, so I had to improvise a little bit and, for example, stack some capacitors on top of each other to reach the values I needed. Now to the capacitors. I've chosen bigger input capacitors because it helps quite measurably to get the ripple down. However, they are very tall and maybe over-dimensioned. This is what was pointed out by some of the viewers of the last part, and I agree that it can be a problem dependent on the layout of a mainboard. For example, if the VRM is facing the CPU and there is not a lot of space in between. Some of you propose to use solid capacitors which can be smaller, provide the same capacitance and lower ESR, which is important for the low output voltage ripple. That's a good proposal, which I also had in mind. However, as I said, there are some delivery issues, and I still didn't get the parts I wanted. I also ordered some smaller caps to play with them, but, well, for this prototype, which has lower parts, I had to salvage some used components from scrap, what didn't end up as good and stable with all of the tested CPUs. So for now, I propose to use some bigger input capacitors with low ESR if possible. Now to the inductor. To be honest, it was a bit problematic to find something useful. I played around with SMD inductors, but I wanted to use through-hole parts here, since the current can be distributed over both sides of the PCB. Remember that it can be up to 11 amps. I even designed this circuit to stand 15 amps. So I tested different coils. The sweet spot seems to be at 3.3 microhenry. However, I also tried this bigger 4.7 microhenry inductor and also a smaller 1.5 microhenry coils. The 4.7 microhenry seems to be a bit sluggish for faster CPUs, and the 1.5 microhenry gets saturated too fast and produces too much ripple. I also made some calculations, and 3.3 microhenry seems to be a good fit, I suppose. Unfortunately, I was not able to buy what I needed, so I grabbed what I had from scrap. However, it is an easy task to make the required coil on your own. A 13mm ferrite toroid with 10 windings does the job. I added this information into the documentation of the project. All the other parts can be obtained from the shelf. Please remember that I designed the circuit more than a year ago, and meanwhile, there seemed to be a DC-DC controller shortage. However, there seemed to be some drop-in replacements available. I ordered some to test them already. You can find the names in the documentation too. So I collected some smaller improvements and created the revision 0.4. I can't show you the actual PCB because I don't have it yet, but it is more or less the same as the revision 0.3, which I used for testing. I just added some ceramic caps for better filtering, and I also added the cutouts left and right from the plug. It is for the side locks in the VRM socket, and initially I found it to be not really necessary because the VRM sits very tightly in the socket. But some viewers mentioned it in the comments, so I decided to incorporate that request eventually as well. And this is how the revision 0.4 looks like. You can find the project on GitHub. The link is in the description below. The Gerber files can be found in releases on the right side. As all of my projects, this one is open source as well. However, this time I'm going to try another license. Usually I used GPL for my projects, but unfortunately some people around the world took my work, removed all mentions of Necroware from the PCBs and sold the parts under own names. This is unfair, to be honest, because I hope that using my projects people will come back, contribute and help me to develop them. If someone erases any mention of Necroware, this will of course never happen and is the worst anti-thank you ever. So this time I'm going to try to go with the Creative Commons Attribution Share-like license. This license allows to modify, sell or do with the project whatever you like, but it is prohibited to remove the names and any change has to be open sourced under the same license. I hope these requirements are just fair. This is the first time I'm using this license, so we will see how it goes. So, where can this module be used? Is the Asus board the only one which supports it? No, as I said in the previous parts, the module specification was defined by Intel in their Pentium mainboard design guidelines, and many manufacturers followed it. Here I have the Gigabyte mainboard, which I showed already. It also has such a VRM feature connector. This one is even socketed. Interesting is that these two boards are both based on the Intel Triton 430FX chipset, and many boards with this chipset had the VRM feature connector too. But also some newer mainboards based on the 430HX and VX chipsets had such an option, although not that often, unfortunately. However, not only Intel chipset-based boards were capable to carry such a VRM. Here I have an FIC PA2000 mainboard, which is based on the VIA Apollo Master MV chipset. This board is quite interesting, and having a K6-2400 running on this one would be even more interesting, because this board officially supports only Pentium 133MHz, not even 166 or 200, not mentioning MMX. and it has a linear voltage regulator which would probably go up in fire would we try to run a Pentium at 233 MHz on it. I don't know if this board is working at all. I didn't test it yet, but if you are interested, I could prepare it for the VRM and try to make some benchmarks against the Intel 430FX mainboards. The chipsets are from the same time, and it would be probably interesting to see how they perform. What do you think? For that, I would of course have to add the VRM feature connector as I did on the Asus mainboard previously, and as you see, the high capacitors would interfere with the CPU cooler here, so I'd have to use the version with smaller capacitors, but I don't consider this as a huge problem. If you find this project useful, I'd be curious to know which mainboards you would like to run it on. I guess in the future we can keep a list of tested mainboards on the project site as well. I tested the VRM so far on the Asus and Gigabyte mainboards, which I showed you, and it runs perfectly stable. I already started to do a lot of benchmarks, and I would like to answer many interesting questions in the next part. I tested a lot of CPUs and more. However, as I was going through my collection, I saw this AMD K5 in the box. I didn't use it for a long time now, and this CPU needs 3.5 volts. It would run fine using the onboard linear voltage regulator, but I would like to have a support for such voltages as well on my voltage regulator module. AMD K5 is not the only one example. There are more, like Winchip for example. Unfortunately, the revision 0.4 of my VRM doesn't provide voltages above 3.2 volts. So I decided to increase the range of supported voltages in the future and started already to work on the revision 0.5. Currently it exists only virtually, but it should be able to cover everything from 1.6 volt to 3.5 volts. It will take some time to build and test it, but I'm pretty sure that it will come, so stay tuned. And as I said, in the next part I'm planning to make a huge benchmark run and compare a lot of different and exciting combinations. Luckily, I could even find a real surprise, which will make this comparison even more exciting. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video and this project. Please let me know what you think about it, and feel free to use the design to build your own VRMs. So far, thank you for watching and goodbye.